113, initiating broadcast of Fascinating Nouns in 3, 2, 1.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Fascinating Nouns. Now, if you are listening to this transmission, we are still the galaxy's most trusted source for incredible people, places, things, and ideas. Now together we arrive at this curious nexus point, and we will explore the strange, unusual, offbeat, bizarre, intriguing, interesting, invigorating, quirky, quaint, quizzical, weird, wild, wacky, the fun, the frivolous, and the fringe, plus all the spaces in between. I am your host, Daniel J. Glenn.
You know, I think as we go through life, we kind of accumulate different types of people. You know, you got your normal people, you got people that you see once in a while, but you got your odd people, your curious people, your intellectual people. And sometimes you meet people who are incredibly good at a very specific niche topic that you didn't even know existed until they told you about it. Well, that is the exact category that tonight's guest falls into. I'm talking about Yinzerella, who is the owner and operator of a website called Dinner is Served 1972. And as I'm sure you can guess, she talks about dinners in 1972. She really looks at retro recipes and tells you like what people were eating back then, what they're doing now. She's got a lot of antique cookbooks, really into this whole idea of, I don't want to say antique cooking, but retro cooking is definitely there. Now, I didn't even know this niche existed until I saw that she was doing it and killing it. Now, Yinzerella and I, we went to school together. We went to grad school together. We studied film and television. We did a lot of projects together. So I knew she was into film, television, but I had no idea about this retro cooking thing. I just found out about it. Here's the embarrassing part. She's been doing this for 10 years and killing it on Instagram, on YouTube, on her website. So the problem may have been that when I knew Yinzerella, she was known as Funquita, the love puppy. So what am I supposed to do? How did I know? But let me get this boom right into the first question here, Yinzerella. So when did you go from full-time Funquita into Yinzerella? You changed your online handle and personality. When did that happen?
Oh, gosh. I want to say, I think I may have been living in Brooklyn at the time. So let's say this was 2000, maybe 2007. I don't know why that, but then I started with fantasy football, just random leagues, I think on NFL.com. And for whatever reason, I was like, oh, I'm Team Yinzerella. And my little icon was the Iron City Beer logo. I don't know why that came to me, but yeah, that's what it was. It was basically my first fantasy football team name.
So I remember seeing that. I don't know when I started following you on Instagram. I have no idea. I don't remember. I don't remember the first time I saw Yinzerella, but I remember I was always fascinated with it because I had no idea what it meant, where it came from. I didn't know what it was. It was just a total random thing. And then about, 4 months ago or something, I came across the term Yinzer, and then...
Oh, you didn't know that beforehand?
No
idea. Well, why would you?
No, I had no clue. And so I came across that, and it was like, oh, person from Pittsburgh. And then I was like, oh! Then it like all connected, and I was like, that's where she got it. What a great name.
Yeah, I just always think it's like, how did no one like really glom onto this earlier? Because every once in a while, then I search it. And I think there was someone who worked for WTAE, which is the ABC affiliate in Pittsburgh. And I think they did a Twitter thing with Yinzerella. And I think there's someone else who is using it for other social media. And I think she may be like a fashion type person. I still don't know why it ended up being me at the... Because how did no one else think about that before, like, plastering it everywhere and taking it?
Yeah. Well, and you don't – do you have it officially? Have you trademarked it? Because someone will just snatch that up from underneath you.
Yeah. I know that there were – I wasn't even looking at it. My boyfriend was, and he's an attorney, although he doesn't do, you know, like, copyright or patent law or whatever. He looked at it, and someone filed it. It was to do – to use the name on, you know – cups, mugs, t-shirts, so on and so forth. And I can't remember the date on it, but apparently then it just kind of, they stopped with it. they paused. So apparently there's been no progress with that.
That is so weird. Well, I mean, you've kind of taken it over. It's kind of yours, but I would hate to see that get snatched out from underneath you. I mean, I've been the Funk Lord forever, but there's lots of other Funk Lords. You know, because like my first fantasy football team was Funk Lord's Furious Faction, and I've been using that ever since I started playing.
See, we have so many things in common, Dan. Yeah, but fantasy football is how we just decided to name ourselves.
Yeah. Well, it's crazy because we're going to get to – I want to put a pin in the fantasy football thing because we're going to get back to that because that's a great storyline. I love it, and we can continue talking about that. One of the things that I wanted to really, really – the whole purpose for this interview is to really answer this one question, and that is on your bio page it says you're a Nicolas Cage super fan. What does that mean, and how do you express that fandom?
I don't know if super fan. Maybe I'm reaching with super fan, but I can say that
your words, not mine, Yinzerella. Your words, not mine.
I don't know anyone else personally who loves Mr. Cage as much as I do, and it's not me just like, oh, I know filmography and. Although it's not like I have pictures of him, although I will say in college and graduate school, I did have some posters, cause that was like his heyday, you know, like late '90s, early 2000s, but no, I've never met anyone else who had any sort of interest in Nicolas Cage the way that I have. I just feel, I really appreciate him. Every movie that I watch of his, you know, you can say it's crap. I think it's art. On some level, the man is an artist, but does he always have something new? No, I mean, think about it. When you watch Nicolas Cage on film, aren't you always seeing something kind of new?
You know, I'll be honest. I don't watch a lot of Nicolas Cage movies. And okay, now well. I feel like I'm out of, I feel like I'm, there's a group I'm not a part of right now that I need to really get in good with very quickly.
There's a large number of Nicolas Cage films that no one has ever seen because they are all direct to video.
Is that true?
Oh, yes. The man is prolific. Okay. After you're done talking with me, this is what you need to do. You need to go onto your Roku or your streaming device of choice and press search and then go to Nicolas Cage. Cause this is sometimes when I'm like, well, what else am I going to watch tonight? I will just search Nicolas Cage and see what's free.
Wow.
He will make like 12 movies in a calendar year. It's insane, but it's amazing. And you know, and I always base it on what's on the cover. A lot of the times it's Nicolas Cage walking with explosions or flames behind him.
Right.
Or running, but you know, they all have fantastic titles and just, you know, it's like Kill Switch.
So in some ways he's like the Stephen King of actors. Like he can put out more movies than you would think humanly possible in a calendar year.
Yes.
Okay. All right. I will 100% do that, and I encourage everyone listening to do that as well. You know, we're going to talk about, obviously, Dinner is Served 1972, which is your opus, your gift to the world, really your life's work. And
it is
what I think, you know, I think once that's kind of done, and it never really will be done for you, I don't think, but maybe a Nicolas Cage website dedicated where you can really make people understand through your own words, through video, whatever you'd like to do. I think that might be your next project. And I want to take full credit for that.
I will say I do have an idea about that.
Okay.
Actually.
All right.
Because I do, one of the things I do is, you know, go through television shows that I love. And if a dish shows up in the show, it's like, okay, well, I can make that, or I will make something inspired from said show. Mm-hmm. I think I may have to do a Nicolas Cage series. and I think number one, it would have to be something involving peaches, because I think we all remember in Con Air.
Of course.
The whole line about peach. I can eat a peach for hours. That, yes, I could just do an entire series of peaches recipes in honor of Mr. Cage.
I love it. As long as you put after my conversation with Daniel J. Glenn on Fascinating Nouns, I've been inspired to do a peach-centered Nicolas Cage opus. And I think that's great. I think that's wonderful. And
you'll get a byline on that. You can have a byline.
I love it. I'll take it, and I will promote the heck out of it. So dinner is served 1972. Your life's work. Yeah. We talked about it. This is it for you. This is the thing. Yinzerella is synonymous with dinner is served 1972. Now, this is basically, if I'm mislabeling this or speaking out of turn, let me know. But I believe this is it's a retro recipe cooking blog with a B. And you kind of look – so it was inspired by the dinner is served recipe cards, which we're going to talk about in a second. Mm-hmm. So those were a thing. That was their actual name, was dinner is served 1972, right?
It all depends on what you look at. But yes, for the most part, they were called dinner served. And the reason I called it dinner served 1972 is because that was the year of the trademark.
Got it.
Because a lot of things are just called dinner served. So it was like, well – it's dinner served, but in 1972.
Very specific dinners. And I'd love that you have a boyfriend who works in the legal industry as an attorney and has absolutely cannot help you at all with trademark patents and all this stuff, which is what you're heavily involved with to avoid jail time or heavy fines.
He does other things. Hey, if you're in Maryland and you get injured, please contact Killian Law Firm. KillianLawGroup.com for your personal injury needs. No, I
all right. With no patent stuff, which is what you could, which is useful.
The law is very vast, you know. Yeah, I mean, not every lawyer can know everything about anything. He knows a lot about a lot of things.
Right.
That perhaps no.
But nothing that can help you with your business at all. That's okay. I'm sure.
Unless I get injured in a car accident, you know, I'm fine otherwise.
Yeah. I mean, slipping on a banana peel is a real occupational hazard for you. I mean, that could happen, and he's the guy. He'll get you. Well, Dole's got deep pockets, and he can get some of that money out for you. So 1972, I love the 70s are my favorite decade. I love the clothes. It's, you know, part of my gimmick. I love it. With you, this is kind of your thing too. You've got a 1970s condo, right? Like the condo you have is from the 70s. You've got some great videos. I'll put a link to your YouTube channel. And in some of your videos, you're in your kitchen, and behind you is the famous 1970s wooden fork and spoon on the wall, which my grandmother had. You had one video where you had a copper grape mold also, which my grandmother had it, it was from the 70s. So that's what – I love all this stuff. So was this kind of like what drew you to the actual year itself with the 70s? Is this all just random coincidence?
The 70s thing, to an extent, was a coincidence just because that was the year that the cards were made. This card set that I got from my Gramsci. I mean, it could have been from 68. It could have been from, you know, 57. It was basically just the set. Itself, it didn't matter about the year. Of course, the thing that really drew me to it was the photography, and that was definitely 70s.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, I mean, the 70s thing was always kind of a thing for me, early 70s, you know, loving the Brady Bunch and all that, kind of love that, you know, wild, wacky kind of aesthetic. But as you said, yeah, the 1970s building. Yeah, I do live in a Frank Gehry building, one of his first buildings, and it was built in 1977 or 78, I think. When I moved into my unit, I'll tell you, a lot of things have not been changed since then. I have the original double oven.
No kidding, really?
Yeah, it works. Yeah, after over 40 years, I love it. And I've thought about if I replace it, what would I do? But they don't have the kind of double oven with the stovetop. They don't make that anymore.
Hmm.
And if they did, definitely not in white, because everything is stainless steel now.
Right. In white. You might be the great. You might be the perfect person to ask this question. So for my other show, I had to watch Invasion of the Body Snatchers and the 1978. It came out in 1978. There's this great scene where the female lead is on the phone. And the phone itself is a rotary phone, but it's actually part of the wall. It's like a panel, right? So it's like built into the wall. And to actually pull the receiver off, it's got a retractable like cord. I mean, it's amazing. Mm-hmm. But that's like only in the 70s. You can't replace the phone. It just is the phone, you know?
I have one of those in the bottom of my closet, actually.
What? Are you serious? It's in your closet? Why would it be in your closet?
because when I moved in, there was one, I don't think the cord is retractable, but exactly what you're talking about was in the kitchen. And I had it removed because all it did was communicate with the downstairs lobby. You know, someone's here, you have a package.
Yeah.
And what I wanted to do, and this is, you know, very of the time, I actually put in a window and a breakfast bar to kind of open things up. That piece, as cool as it was just slightly wider than I needed to make, you know, what I wanted to happen. So I had it removed, but I do have it in the floor of one of my closets. I never got rid of it.
Oh my God, that is amazing.
Yeah.
That is unbelievable.
So, I know exactly what you're talking about. I could drag it out from my closet.
You should drag it out and take a picture, and I will post it if you can send me one.
I will
post it. That is, like, to me, that is perfect. Brown and avocado color. Those were very 70s. I love that stuff. So I'm with you on this whole world. I love this idea of retro cooking. Now, how did you get into this? I mean, it sounds like you were just thrust into this world, that this was thrust upon you from your grandmother. How did this happen? Was it kismet or synchronicity, or what was it?
I can tell you exactly what it was, and it is so mundane and boring, and I wish that there was a better story to it. I ended up with her small collection of cookbooks, which was extremely small because she was not the best cook, nor did she cook a lot, because she actually worked full-time, when my mom was growing up and all that. So I ended up with them, and the dinner serve carts, you know, sitting in front of the TV, just mindlessly, just flipping through them. And it was my boyfriend at the time. This is all him. He said, "Why are you just looking through them? Like, just stop it. Why don't you start cooking them? Why don't you write about them?" And I was like, "Well, that's a good idea."
Yeah.
So I did. I started. Yeah. I mean, that was basically what it was. And it was like, well, that, you know, I like to write. I need something to do. I did not know how to cook at all, which kind of made it, you know, even more of a fun project, because I then did, throughout this process, kind of teach myself how to cook. But yeah, that there was no like magical moment where it's like, I'm inspired. No, it was like, why don't you try this? Yeah. Okay. And then it stuck. I ended up liking it.
That is, I don't know if it's boring, but it's, you know, it is mundane. That's, you know, that's not the,
it is.
But I mean, it's still cool. Your grandmother had them. She didn't use them. These were unused. I mean, I think you had to crack the cellophane on them, you know, the original cellophane.
They were never touched. They were in pristine condition. And since then, of course, they all look like shit because my grubby hands have been all over them for the past, you know, I guess 9 years.
It's cool because you have this great picture on the website, and I'm going to have it on I've copied some of your pictures onto my Pinterest page. I've saved them so that connects to both of our pages, but you've got some incredible pictures. We'll talk about your vintage cookbook collection. We've got tons of those. But my favorite picture that you have is an article. It's an advertisement from the Prescott Courier, I believe. It's an Arizona newspaper, and the Arizona part's actually important because there's a cool thing on there I bet you didn't see. But the advertisement is for these cards, which essentially were kind of like baseball cards for women, I guess. You know, you could collect them, you could trade them. They're similar, right?
Well, and as long as you were someone who could drive and was filling up your tank at a Chevron or other related gas station, right, these could be the cards for you.
Lots of female foot traffic around the Chevron station, right?
So basically, male, woman, I mean, as long as you were in a car filling up, you know, your tank, these are the cards for you. So, yeah.
I love that. So this is a little bit of irony, okay? So on that advertisement, I want you to go back and look at the full page ad. But on that exact same page, the advertisement takes up about 7/8 of the page. So there's a column on the left-hand side. And it's funny because that is a female-centered advertisement, you know, geared towards women about recipes. In that column is an advertisement promoting Bill Cosby's comedy show at Northern Arizona University, and they call him the cool one in that, which is a really fun read. I took the picture from the original site, so I've got it up there, but you should definitely take a look. It's great.
Well, you know, the cause was super cool until he wasn't.
Well, I think he was doing some pretty uncool stuff the entire time.
I'm sure he was at that time too.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
You know.
I mean, it was a college campus, so, you know, I don't know if he was on his best behavior. So,
sweet baby Jesus.
So before we talk about these cards, do you have the original green recipe holder as well?
Oh yeah, I have three of them.
Wow, really?
Are you talking about the box or the little easel you can set the card up in?
Okay, I didn't know about that. I was talking about the green box. It's literally like a recipe box. It says dinner is served on it, like very mold, plastic injection, you know.
I have three.
Wow.
I have three of them. I have my grandmother's, and then I have purchased two others subsequently to have complete sets.
That's great. So you have, how many complete sets do you have of 72?
Well, it depends. Oh, of 72, then I have three. Of 73, I want to say I have 2.5 because the last set from 202 to 212, I could never find. They were always this like weird outlier. And actually a blogger friend of mine had them and she mailed them to me.
Unbelievable.
Well, her website is fantastic. She's vintagerecipecards.com.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I was looking at her stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. And she was like, hey, I've already taken pictures of them all. Do you want them? And I was like, yes, I do.
Wow.
So she sent them to me in the actual like envelope that they came in.
Oh, geez.
Which I'd never seen before. Yeah. So I have that. It was like, you really did me a solid.
That's amazing. Yeah. I'll put a link to her page as well, just because I feel like we owe her something. I think that she's really completed your set here. That was the last year they did it, right? 1973?
Mm-hmm. As far as I know.
And is it true you've begun hoarding the 1973 run one so that no one else can have them? Or is that a rumor that is untrue?
No one needs to hoard them because I have come across so few of them. The two that I have are really the only two I've ever seen. But I will say the best thing about the first one that I bought, because every once in a while I'd be, you know, just randomly search it and be like, oh, it's there. Well, I went on the, I don't know if it was Etsy or eBay, and the copy describing the set was 100% listed from my blog.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing.
So when I was buying it, I was like, you know, I should get a discount because you just...
My boyfriend's an attorney, and like I believe that that's copyright infringement, so I'm just saying.
No, I was like, oh, yes, Dinner is Served is a recipe card set of, you know, so many cards that is designed to tell you, like, when you should start dinner. Yeah, I was like, okay, thank you.
You know what's kind of cool about that is you are kind of really... like you kind of hold the flame for the Dinner is Served set. It's really hard to find any information about them that doesn't lead back to you or vintagerecipes.com. That's really the last place that, I mean, I can't even find the company. Marjan Promotions, I believe, is the name of the company. I can't even find anything for that. Like, you guys are really the keeper of the flame here. How does it feel? Is that a big responsibility, do you feel? And are you going to pass it on to someone else at some point?
Yes, me and Miss Surly over at VintageRecipeCards.com, you know, we're taking this responsibility, you know, we're taking it to heart. It's really a serious matter. It's a blip, you know. If people have fun with it, fantastic.
It's history. This is history.
Sort of like weird. I'm a weird historian.
You are.
You're telling me this. Maybe I am a weird historian.
You are. You're a niche. But here's what I love about this. This is why it kind of speaks to me. Is it is a very specific moment in time, you know, and it's because one of the things I wanted to learn from you is, did this kind of teach you anything about kind of culinary tastes in that specific year, knowing what you know now and have, you know, lived, you know, a while, right? We both lived a while.
We're not going to talk about how old I am, Dan.
No, no, no.
Let's not talk about how old I am.
But you've seen a lot of dinners come and go, is what I'm saying. You've seen a lot of food fads come and go. Is it kind of cool to really have honed in on this one very specific year and what people liked, what they've put, you know, because one of the cool things on your website is you say that improvisation and modification are really the keys to your cooking because some of the stuff is, you know, it's very unique, let's say. So I don't know, is there anything, have you learned anything kind of cool about 1972 in regards to culinary taste?
There are some ways it's just been very much, what were you thinking? Why did you think that these were things that were okay to do? Case in point, tuna macaroni loaf. I will say in tuna cheese macaroni loaf, in its defense, that was one of the first things I did. So maybe I could have, you know, done a better version of it, one that would not have just stuck in the loaf pan and just crumbled into kind of like a heap of canned tuna and macaroni and cheese.
Mm-hmm.
Although actually, even if that had come out in a loaf, that probably would not have been the best thing.
Tell that to the lovers of Tuna Helper, by the way.
Yeah, it's like I'm sorry, guys. No, it's interesting because there were a lot of like canned items where I don't think you can necessarily find today. Like it would be like can of number 2 white sauce or light white sauce. Mm. It's like, well, what the hell is that? How am I buying that canned? And that's one of the things that led me to actually trying to figure out how to make my own white sauce.
Mm.
And actually, number 1, learn what the hell white sauce is. That was
yeah. And what white sauce number 2 one. Is and the difference between the number 1 and number 2.
Yes. Yeah, basically. It was like, okay, so it forced me to learn how to make a sauce. So the number 1 thing I learned is that they were very, very scared of seasonings.
Yeah.
So it's kind of counterintuitive because you would think, oh, putting canned this and canned that and all that, that things would be too salty. They aren't. So it was very quickly I realized that whatever amount of spices or salt or anything that they asked for, it was like, you got to double that shit.
Really?
Yeah. That's what, at least for my palate, I don't know, my tongue could be completely, ravaged from years of smoking. So I'm a former smoker, but I smoked for many years and maybe it's that and then hot food. I don't know.
Right.
But I will say it was kind of, I don't know, interesting. It was like, oh, there was a lot of, actually, maybe that's not right. I was very surprised by the lamb curry dish that there was.
Mm-hmm.
Because the lamb curry tasted much better than I really thought it would have. There were just some things that they were just surprises.
Do you find more hits than misses? Like,
yes, more hits than misses, which blew my mind. Because, oh, I'll tell you one thing that really did blow my mind. I think it was tuna 3 ways.
Menage a tuna.
Now I'm like, yeah, no, that's basically, now I'm like, oh God, as I'm just like, right. Anyway, because I hate canned tuna.
Mm-hmm.
But it was tuna salad 3 different ways, and I didn't hate it. And that was one of those moments where I was like, well, maybe these people have got something. Maybe. And so then from there on, it was like, well, I'm going to – because I went in with trepidation for so many dishes, being like, I'm going to hate this.
Yeah.
And then it was, let's say, like 2 years in, I was like, you know what? There's probably – 50-50 chance that I may not hate this.
Well, it's interesting because, you know, I was wondering, like, how, like, did this improve your cooking skills? Or, I mean, do you cook regular things? Are you so busy cooking the retro stuff? There's this great blog post that you have where basically it was, I think it was a Bisquick brownie, impossible brownie pie. And it was, your response was funny. It is, you brought it into work and you're like, well, my coworkers have learned to avoid some of the crazy weird retro recipes I bring in. And when there's a choice between a regular dish and a retro dish, the blog comes first or something. And I really appreciated your commitment to excellence there, by the way. But I wondered, like, are you the weird recipe lady who makes stuff that sounds weird but tastes terrible? Or has this improved your skills and you just enjoy making some of these fun things from yesteryear?
As someone who had really never cooked before, I will say, you know, it's 9 years in. I think my parents are still amazed that I cook and cook constantly. You know, making cereal was too much. I had no knowledge of anything whatsoever. So embarking on this whole project, yes, I do know how to cook now. When we talked about it earlier about making a white sauce from the can, I couldn't get the can. Yes, I know how to make sauces. I can make a roux. I can make any sort of, you know, level of thickness of a sauce that you want now.
Wow.
When it comes to going to parties or work things, yes, people do expect me to bring something that is from one of my
1972
one of my cookbooks. Or whatever, right. whatever year.
Sure, sure.
And I will say, yes, the brownie thing was a fail, but I did. There was a woman that I worked with, and every year for her birthday, I would make something Jell-O based and then put a man that she loved in it.
Okay.
That's so weird.
Yeah,
I made a Jell-O pie with Prince in it. I made a better than Tom Selleck cake with Tom Selleck in it. I made a strawberry Jell-O pie with John Hamm in it.
Wow.
Those things, if it was, a lot of the stuff was, they were actually winners.
Okay. Okay.
Which I think, so it really, when it was doing work or parties, it really is 50-50. They're either really good or really bad.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there's no middle ground. It's like they're extremists. They're extremist recipes, really.
I don't know if they're extremist recipes. Maybe there are extremist taste buds.
Okay. Okay. Sure.
Let's go with that.
Yeah,
maybe.
Yeah. Well, that's fair. I mean, you know, I love the idea. And so when you got the original thing, the thing that kicked this thing off was the Dinner Served 1972. Mm-hmm. When you got the idea to start making them, most people would think to themselves, oh, we'll do them in order or there's some kind of pattern. But from what I understood, if my research is correct, number one is beef stew, which you didn't start with. You started with fruit stuffed pork loin and medallions,
yes.
Which from what I understand is incredibly difficult, especially the medallions part. Why did you start with that random number 41 instead of number one?
A lot of it had to do with what was available at my Safeway that day.
Okay, fair enough. So Safeway dictated the order recipe.
Safeway did. Just what I was in the mood for. I wasn't going to do any sort of, you know, chronological order thing.
No.
Because, you know, like I just said, sometimes you do not want to make a giant beef Wellington dinner for, you know, six people when it's just two of you.
Right. That makes sense.
That's really, it was like, oh, this is a weeknight, so I can make the one that has the timeline from 5 to 6.
Got it.
If it's a Sunday, okay, I'll do one that, you know, it's a pot roast that starts at 2 and then we eat at 6.
Right.
So that was a lot. That was dictating it. And then a lot of it was, I would go to the store. It's like, oh, this cut of beef is on sale. Okay, cool. Oh, I have that recipe to make with this. Fantastic. Economics is a big reason why I was pairing things the way I did.
Okay.
Or selecting the order image.
That makes a lot of sense. It's cool to see, because on your blog, you've kind of organized it in a great way where you have them all numbered and then they're just, you can just click on them and then you can read the blog entry and how you made them and kind of get all that information on there, which I thought was just great. And you mentioned something that I thought was one of my favorite parts of the cards, where basically it tells you when to start. So if you want it ready at 6, it says start at 3, do this, 3:30, do this, 4 o'clock. It's got the whole schedule on the back on the actual recipe card itself. Are those pretty accurate? Did you follow those or did you kind of do your own thing?
I tried as best I could to follow
them. Yeah.
That.
Did it work? No?
Sometimes.
Okay.
I don't, yes, sometimes. Other times, let's just say life gets in the way.
Sometimes life finds a way. Sometimes life gets in the way. Life, right?
I don't know. Sometimes you're just, you know, you're drinking and then you get kind of wrapped up in something. It all depends on, or, I mean, basically for me, the number one thing was, you know, user error.
Right.
Like, oh,
right.
It would take an hour for someone, you know, who knew what they were doing to make, you know, X. It's taking me an hour and a half because I have no idea what I'm doing.
Right.
I'm falling all over myself trying to find ingredients and, you know, shredding things and all that. No, and they're a great guideline. I will say, however, I do think I'm getting a little better with it.
Okay, I would hope so. After 9 years.
After
you don't sound very emphatic, like, yeah, I've been nailing it. And early on, it's pretty difficult. But man, am I getting it now? It's like, I think I'm a little better. All right.
I mean, not a resounding assessment of your skill, but, you know, you're making it.
As long as I get the end result. It's all about the journey, right?
Sure, yeah. Well, you've done some pretty cool stuff because on your YouTube page, I mean, you're grinding your own meat for sausages. You're cooking beef tongue. You're cooking, I mean, you're very into organs, by the way, which is something. Mm-hmm. That's something. And so there's a lot of very strange things. But these things are not easy to do. So there's a learning curve with anything. But I was just curious if, because those recipes are kind of geared towards people who, you know, maybe don't know how to cook or want to spice up and, you know, do something a little different than Taco Tuesday or Pork Chop Night. I was just wondering how specific those schedules were. I'd never seen it on a recipe before, on a recipe card, and I thought that was really interesting. Now I got a bombshell for you, Yinzerella. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to probably throw your entire world, the history of this blog, as you know it, is about to be turned on its head. And it's going to start with a simple question. And that question is, Do you remember how we met?
Well, I know how we met initially is because of school. In my mind, I'm just thinking about us doing the video for the booze cruise, and we were making like the 5-layer fiesta.
That's exactly right.
Poorly.
That was
really?
That's exactly right. We were working on the booze cruise. We made a 5-layer dip of some kind. We had guacamole, sour cream. It was a very simple recipe. This was for a class. We went to college together. This is our first video production class. It was our first video production assignment.
Yeah, it was.
We got thrown together, and we created something out of nothing. We created this recipe. We were cooking together, and this predates the beginning of Dinner is Served. So in some ways here, my importance to your cooking career supersedes that of your grandmother. And I don't want to say that lightly, but I feel like I'm significantly more important. Would you agree with that statement?
Yeah, I am going to go with that 100% because
yeah. Good. I didn't know what you're going to say there, but I'm glad you
because
did.
No, I mean, we made more than just the bean dip. Whoa. We made, I think it was strawberry margaritas
yes.
on the fly with a time limit and having to look at 3 different cameras.
Uh-huh.
So, yes, you, Dan, you have been, I've been waiting my entire life. You started me on this journey because my goal now is to, I want that show, right?
Mm-hmm.
Once I get that show, you're going to come on the show with me. We're going to make that same dip and that same margarita.
So two things on that. Number one, of course, I went through all of my videos to see if I could find that so that I could put it online. For
do you
us.
Have it?
So I,
do you have
I,
it?
So here's the thing. I think I do. I think I've located the tape. But my camera has suddenly decided, my one that plays mini DV tapes, because that's what it was recorded on, has decided not to play tapes anymore. So now I have to find a mini DV tape deck and then pull it off of there. But I will post that as soon as I am able, and I will definitely give you a copy of that because I think it would be very fun to watch the beginning of your cooking career. And I should also mention
yeah.
that on that same shoot, you said one of the funniest things, which no one listening is going to think it's very funny, but I want to tell you that I've thought about it many times since then, and you one of the props they had was this like shag carpet jacket. It was a green long shag carpet jacket. And I remember I put it on as a joke.
I don't remember that. I do not remember that at all.
I put it on, and then you asked me if that was a real Muppet fur jacket, and I thought that was the funniest thing I'd ever heard, and I've remembered it since. And I've used it on several occasions. So,
I had that, and then the other videos, because apparently no one else wanted to be on camera, with the exception of...
I think it was like the two of us, yeah, yeah.
That makes sense,
yeah.
Right? This completely tracks.
Yeah.
But I had them, and I had them on a ripped to the DVD, and the box that it was in sat next to a radiator for a little bit too long.
Oh no!
So I lost it forever. So if you have it, I would love to see it.
I think I do. I will make you a copy. I will digitize it and make it digital instead. I won't send you a mini DV tape, although that would be very funny. I will not do that. The other thing is that this would have been a great show. Obviously, with the quarantine and the distance, we can't do a cooking show, but this would have been a great video extra for both of our YouTube channels to do a nice retro dish, which is just such an opportunity lost. But hopefully I can find that the recording where it all started for you, and I was glad to be a part of that. So now let's move on to some of the other – I want to talk about a couple of things here. You have a vintage cookbook collection, and I just love
mm-hmm.
this idea. I went through some of the pictures on your website, which is it's just amazing to see. It's again, I think I love this so much because it reminds me of my grandmother. Like you have the Frugal Gourmet, you've got like several other like Julia Child, Better Homes and Gardens. One's like cooking with cheese. It's like the Better Fondue. Like it's such specific moments in time. I just love your cookbook collection, but. On that, you know, you mentioned TV show recipes. You do a lot of other great stuff besides this Dinner is Served 1972, which is, you know, kind of what started it all. You've done a lot of other really fun things, including this idea of these TV show recipes. So before, yeah, I want to get this story out because this I thought was just an absolutely crazy story. But you are a fan of the TV show Hannibal. And this kind of ties back into your fantasy football stuff as well. We're going to come full circle here as we round it up. But tell me about how you got into Hannibal, which for our listeners, I want to remind you that it is about a cannibalistic doctor who marinates and cooks up his, patients. I don't even actually know who he cooks up, but I know that they're people. So how
did... Anyone he knows, and anyone he meets, they could be cooked up.
No pun intended. Anyone he meets becomes his meat. So tell me how this, first of all, how did this love of eating people and making real food kind of come together? And then how does this kind of parlay into your cool videos that you did?
You know what, to be quite honest, I have no idea why I watched the first episode of Hannibal. Mm. I honest to God have no idea, because it's not like I was a huge Thomas Harris fan. I mean, I liked Silence of the Lambs, but there wasn't any sort of like, oh my God, it's Hannibal Lecter, mm-hmm. because I thought that the Hannibal and Red Dragon movies just sucked. But anyway, mm-hmm. I did watch it, and it wasn't because of the food or anything, but it was because of the characters and how beautiful it was, mm-hmm. and you know, the relationship and all this. Anyway, I got sucked into the show, and it was then, I guess after the first season, I'm trying to think when it was that I actually started cooking from it. I guess it was season 3. It was going to be the last season. And I was so into the show and was so deep into cooking for the blog and was doing recipes in the past for other shows. I think it was probably not long after I had finished the Mad Men series of recipes that maybe I was looking for something else, and Hannibal with all the food just kind of like went hand in hand. But I was doing some recipes just inspired from it, and then after the show ended, because I loved it so much, I then purchased once the show ended, they had a prop auction. I purchased 3 recipe cards that weren't used on the show, but they were set dressing. And so when I received those, I decided to cook all 3 of them and do them on video. And so the 3 that I had was pork liver and bacon, beef tongue and horseradish, and Italian sweet sausage. And so I took those 3 cards and I was like, here we go, guys. I got everything and, you know, set up the camera and I filmed myself doing it.
They're really great videos. I mean, the beef tongue one is shocking. I'll say that to people who are listening. It's definitely weird. If you're not used to that, it's definitely unique. Now, from what I remember, you used the money you won from a fantasy football tournament. So mm-hmm. you won fantasy football that year as the Hannibal Lecter face masks. Is that right?
Yes. My team name was Hannibal Lecter's face mask. I took it all. I won $800 that year, and all $800 I spent on memorabilia in the Hannibal auction.
Was that a stipulation of winning, or is this just something you wanted to do?
No, that was me, you know, deciding to do that because I was in the moment instead of, you know, doing other things.
Sure.
Like paying off, you know, some credit card debt, or maybe shooting some Botox or injectables
sure,
into my face.
Sure, yeah. Right.
So I bought the recipe cards, and then I bought a lot of other set pieces that were letters, that were fan letters to Hannibal Lecter that were used in a prison scene.
Now, I have to ask you one other very important question here. And so this is really for the football fans out there. So I've never understood why people change their fantasy football name every year, but I'm not going to ask you about that. I've been Funk Lord's Furious Faction for 7 years, and I will do that into the future. That's my commitment to excellence to everyone listening. But for you, you got Yinzerella. Yinzer, Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. I feel like Pittsburgh Steelers fans, even people who are not from Pittsburgh love the Steelers. The love for that team is very strong. Yet, is that true for you? Let me ask you that question first. Are you a Pittsburgh Steelers fan?
Well, of course I am.
So my second question then is, how come in your videos, and I believe one of the Hannibal Lecter ones, if I'm misspeaking, it's definitely in one of your videos, you have a Green Bay Packers crock pot.
Yes.
What's happening? What's going on there? You have some serious questions you need to answer. You're on the clock.
That was not my crock pot. I did not have a crock pot at the time.
This wouldn't hold up in a court of law.
I had a crock pot, but not one large enough to fit said beef tongue. So I had to borrow one. Now, if I was going to borrow, a crock pot labeled with any other team, it would be the Green Bay Packers, because the Packers are, no, they are. They are my NFC team. They are old school. They, you know, they're old school.
Uh-huh.
They're very much the same vein of the Pittsburgh Steelers. And also, I will say that I love my crazy ass ex-boyfriend, Brett Favre. He is insane. I loved him. I will love him until the day I die. Crocs and all.
Wow. All right. Well, that explains it. That's a fair explanation. Okay, that will hold up in a court of law. If I was on the jury, I wouldn't
okay.
I wouldn't convict you of any national football crimes. So you're free. You're no longer a felon in my eyes. One of the other things that you make, so that's a TV recipe for Hannibal. This one is my favorite because you mentioned, so you did one for the X-Files. It's a pretty simple recipe. It's a pizza. I think it's like a green pepper, mushroom, sausage pizza, whatever. It's a pretty simple recipe. But what I love about it is you pulled it from my favorite X-Files episode of all time, Bad Blood.
Yes!
That is such a great, I love that you mentioned the episode and how great it is. And that is such a cool, that would be a fun thing to do, is make that pizza and watch that episode. I love that one.
Thanks. There are a few episodes of The X-Files that are just go-tos that just make me so happy. Bad Blood, Small Potatoes is definitely one. I don't know, not sadly, but I guess the common thread there is Darren Morgan, who wrote all those. And I know definitely in Small Potatoes he starred in as well. And I know that he was responsible for with the revival. There were a couple of very funny episodes, and I think he wrote those too as well.
Wow, they're great. That one's just amazing. I love it. And I think one of the Wilsons is in it. Is it Owen Wilson? Is he in that, or is it the?
Oh, it's
Luke Wilson.
It's Luke Wilson. Yeah. And the best thing is when he looks like all bucktooth and backwards to Mulder, but then he looks sexy, clean Luke Wilson like to Scully. It's a great episode. So fantastic.
That's my favorite line exchange, is where he comes in and he's talking to Mulder and he's like, "You almost beat a government people." And then the other guy, and then the Scully's like, "Hello, you FBI agents. How are you?" Dana Scully, it's a pleasure. It's a really
so good.
Good one. So now this culmination of your body of work led you to one very important moment in your life. And that was showing, that was appearing on the television show Chopped. How did this go down? This is actually a pretty cool thing. How did you kind of score this? And tell me about your experience on that.
Like me starting the Dinner Served series, it's such a boring story as to how I ended up on Chopped. I didn't even apply. Someone called me and was like, "Hey, would you be interested?" And I was like, "Well, yeah, sure." And so that's how I went through the entire audition process.
Was pretty ho-hum and humdrum,
going
like,
through the
yeah.
Well, no, actually, I was on vacation at the time. I was, I think I was in New Orleans. I was getting on a plane or off a plane, and I got the email, and I was like, "Well, this is just weird and bizarre." And initially, I thought it was some sort of, like, spam. But then I looked into it, and I was like, "Oh, no, this is for real," which was very bizarre, but I guess also flattering at the same time. I went through the entire audition process, which, like everything else, it's like you have to do A and B and C and D. So it ended up, you know, so it was like phone and then Skype. And then after another Skype, they then came to my apartment and then they shot the bio package, for lack of a better term, where they do like the intros and everything.
Okay.
And however many months later, then I ended up going to New York and shooting for half a day. That wasn't a really good description of what happened, though. I'm so sorry.
That was absolutely awful. Let me see if I can save it really quickly.
Thank you.
I'll see what I can do. You know,
God,
this is my life's work. So when you were on the show, but it sounds kind of exciting because things kind of worked out for you, because when you were on the show, first of all, it's a cooking show. It's a competition show. And also, they brought you on for a very special thing. It was basically 60s and 70s kitsch. You had some celebrity judges. I believe they were the Brady Bunch. They were some of the Brady kids were some of the judges, and you were a Brady Bunch fan. And I believe you even wrote a piece on the Brady Bunch in high school. So despite your introduction and your ho-hum attitude going into it, it sounds like this could have been a dream come true. What do you think about that?
It ended up being just a much better experience than I even would have thought it had been, because they obviously selected me to be with the Brady kids. I'm assuming that's what it was. I was on brand for that. I was such a Brady fan and still am, but when I was in high school, and I always, while I was going through the whole rigmarole with the day of, and it's like talking to Maureen McCormick, Christopher Knight, and Susan Olsen, and then talking to the producers, you know, backstage. The
name drop in there.
Confessionals. Yeah. Okay. Confessionals, for lack of a better term. I think I was the only person who was really, really stoked to see the Bradys, because one of the contestants I was with, the first guy who was, let's say, I don't know how much younger than he was to me, but he actually went out and they had to send him back to go back in because he had no idea who they were. I, of course, knew who they were. I lost my mind when I walked out. And if anyone sees the video, you can see how much I lose my mind. And it was 100% genuine. There was nothing being put on there because someone said something about that. And I was like, fuck you. That was real. But yes, huge, huge Brady fan growing up. And then in the mid-90s, when I was in high school, there was the giant like Brady revival with the Brady movie, you know, with Shelley Long and, oh gosh, Gary Cole. So that was definitely like, you know, on the brain. And there was kind of a 70s fashion revival. So yes, I was 100% into that when I was in high school, you know, Brady, you know, ride or die and all that. And so it was something that I kind of really hadn't thought about in a long time, although definitely the Bradys has influenced my, you know, aesthetic. And, you know, definitely I think about them all the time when I'm doing my 1970s cooking.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I huge Brady fan, and was actually writing about them in my high school newspaper. I had a television column, and I know one of it was just like, this is why the Brady Bunch is awesome. Yes, we could be talking about, you know, Friends or whatever was on at the time, but let's talk about the Bradys and how awesome they are. Yeah, so no, I am just huge, huge, huge Brady Bunch.
Do you have that? Do you have any of the columns, any of the newspaper columns about the Brady Bunch from high school?
100% I do.
Can I have one?
Yeah, I can. I will scan those for you. You can have them tomorrow.
Awesome. I will put those up on the Pinterest page. I'm very excited to read what your 17-year-old thoughts were about the Brady Bunch. I think that that's great. And I love the fact that the guy, your competition, they had to reshoot him walking out and being nonplussed by the Bradys. And then they couldn't possibly have juxtaposed that against you losing your mind when you walked out. So you didn't know it was them. That was a total surprise.
It was a surprise. They just said, oh, the guest judges are television icons. I was like, well, what the hell does that mean? That could be anyone. Yeah. But, you know, then watching the episode, it's like, oh, well, I'm the only one that really just, but that, I mean, that just, it knocked me out.
Did they have to medicate you, or were you able to continue on with the...
No, but I mean, I don't know, Dan, did you get to see it at all? I don't know how available it is.
No, I can't find it. Do you have a copy of it?
I do. I will send it to you. It's kind of like, I kind of like did screen grabs from things. There's like really no audio, but the best part of it is, you know, they're like, what about the, you know, you walked in, and I was like, speechless. I'm doing this like, you know, fluttering thing with I walk in, it's the phrase, I'm speechless. Yeah, it's, you know, very cool. It was a very cool look on me.
That's great. So you really went from 0 to 100. You went from like, I'll do this as a favor to the producers of Chopped, to this is the greatest moment in my life. Right? Is that the turnaround?
Well, it was not a favor. It was more like, thank you for the invite. Yeah. Well, very, so much of it was like, well, okay, I'll do that. You know, people are like, oh God, but you got kicked out. I was like, dude, I was so happy to be knocked out the first round, because we started at, you know, like 5 a.m. It was after 1. They had given us no food. And, you know, I was kind of like, I just wanted to be on TV. I was so happy to be done. I went out. I like then had myself a little snack, some glasses of rosé. It was fantastic. I then went to a bookstore, cookbook store, vintage cookbook store.
That's specific.
Like, right up there
that's,
in the Upper East Side.
Very niche. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
No, there was a cookbook store like walking distance from where I was staying. I was like, well, this is amazing. So then I went and bought myself some cookbooks. It was an amazing day.
And you didn't get to keep the apron, which is the best part of the story to me. You worked on an apron, you ruined it, and they were like, excuse me, we'd like to have that apron back, please.
Yeah, it sucked.
I love that part. That's my favorite part of the story.
I wish I had that apron. I was like, you're taking the apron? And it's like, dude, I could have just been chopped person for Halloween for the next 10 years.
They ruined it for you. Well, now if people, you know, if people have been inspired to kind of create their own very specific historical dishes, how can people get in touch with you? Are you on social media? How can people get in touch with your website? You know, there's tons of people. I want to connect them to you. How do I do it?
Oh, well, the easiest way, of course, is to go to dinnerserve1972.com.
Mm-hmm.
But you can also use dinnerserve1972 to find me on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook, and I think on that may be the searchable thing on Pinterest or Yinzerella
or YouTube as well.
There's a 50% shot. Yeah. Oh, on YouTube, I'm dinnerserve1972 as well. And the thing is, though, if you don't find me through that on something, you can search Yinzerella, and there's a 50% chance it may be some like basic girl from Pittsburgh. But, you know, the other 50% chance is you'll find me and my fabulousness.
Right.
So, yeah, dinnerserve1972. Just, you know, you can find me everywhere.
And I will have links to all of that stuff on the website to kind of make sure that it's easy to find for everyone. That's a service I like to provide for people. Yinzerella, I want to thank you so much for this and reigniting my love for the 70s, which I feel, much like your initial call with Chopped, was waning, but now I feel inspired, much like your interaction with the television icons from the Brady Bunch. We're leading almost parallel lives, and I want to thank you for not only sharing this story with me, but also sharing the dinners of 1972, the dinners of yesteryear. Yinzerella, thank you so much for that and for being on the show today.
Oh my God. Thank you. I mean, that's high praise from someone who calls himself the Funk Lord. I mean, that's 70s high praise. So you've just warmed the cockles of my heart.
Well, that's what I try to do. I'm no chef, but warming cockles is one of my expertise. But I want to thank you for being on the show, and I want to thank everyone for listening. Have a good night.
End of transmission. Thank you.